This week we turn to Luke's writing, which is an account in two Acts, the gospel biography of Jesus and the story of the early church, the Jesus community. Now, whether you were a Jew or a Gentile in those days, deciding to become a part of this illegal early Christian movement could bring punishment for your allegiance. Surely the message in Luke and the prophet Isaiah that the downcast, the lowly, and the oppressed would rise up is a welcome and inspirational account. Like the Jewish exile people of Isaiah's time, and like the early Christians, we also wonder sometimes where God is in our suffering. We long to hear the promise that the reason for joyful praise is the good news on the way.
The loneliness of fear.
The invisibility of the next step.
The yearning for presence.
Let us pray. Holy One, we thank you for the glimpses we catch of your gift of the depths of joy, even in the midst of fear, of challenge, of struggle. Even when we are not sure of your presence, ignite the flame of joy within us.
That we might glow with its brilliance from the inside out.
Help us face the silence of unknowing and embrace it as a pregnant pause before a joyful new beginning. Amen. You're invited to light your third candle of joy at home now. A reading from the Gospel according to Luke. When Elizabeth was 6 months pregnant, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a city in Galilee, to a virgin who was engaged to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David's house. The virgin's name was Mary. When the angel came to her, he said, "Rejoice, favored one, the Lord is with you." She was confused by these words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. The angel said, "Don't be afraid, Mary. God is honoring you. Look, you will conceive and give birth to a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of David, his father. He will rule over Jacob's house forever, and there will be no end to his kingdom." Then Mary said to the angel, "How will this happen since I haven't had relations with a man?" The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come over you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the one who is to be born will be holy. He will be called God's Son. Look, even in her old age, your relative Elizabeth has conceived a son. This woman who was labeled unable to conceive is now 6 months pregnant. Nothing is impossible for God." Then Mary said, "I am the Lord's servant. Let it be with me just as you have said." Then the angel left her. Mary got up and hurried to a city in the Judean highlands. She entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the child leapt in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. With a loud voice, she blurted out, "God has blessed you above all women, and he has blessed the child you carry. Why do I have this honor that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as I heard your greeting, the baby in my womb jumped for joy. Happy is she who believed that the Lord would fulfill the promises he made to her." Mary said, "With all my heart, I glorify the Lord. In the depths of who I am, I rejoice in God, my Savior. He has looked with favor on the low status of his servant. Look, from now on, everyone will consider me highly favored because the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. He shows mercy to everyone, from one generation to the next, who honors him as God. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered those with arrogant thoughts and proud inclinations. He's pulled the powerful down from their thrones and lifted up the lowly. He's filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty-handed. He has come to the aid of his servant Israel, remembering his mercy, just as he promised to our ancestors, to Abraham and to Abraham's descendants forever." Mary stayed with Elizabeth about 3 months. Then she returned to her home. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us, thanks be to God. Amen.
On this Cantata Sunday, Chancel Choir is proud to present to you Mary's Magnificat, which we heard in our gospel reading today. The three movements will explore Mary's emotions as she realizes that she is no longer a typical teenage child, but God's chosen one.
Echoing today's scripture, we hear words straight from Mary's heart, words of joy, of honor, and of bewilderment. On learning that she is carrying the Son of God, Mary's spirit has rejoiced. Listen now to the Magnificat, or Song of Mary, in Latin.
Magnificat.
Mary's excitement turns towards a fuller understanding of who this child is in the next movement of our cantata. Those who have become parents can probably understand Mary's turn of emotion. Joy mixed with a sense of heavy responsibility accompanies expectant parents. But Mary's worry is not just pregnancy jitters, and she wonders, shall I rejoice? Her intuition foreshadows the trouble ahead for her son and the fullness of the child growing within her, the Savior of the world.
Thank you.
The final movement, Gloria Patri, which translates Glory be to the Father, we hear a hymn of praise to God. When we sing the Gloria Patri, we call upon ourselves and others to give glory to God. We give glory to God for the child Mary held within her. We give glory to God for Mary's willingness to birth Emmanuel, God with us. We give glory to God in the hope that was born a long time ago and can be born in us again this year. May the song bring us to a place where even during a pandemic, we can sense the hope of God being born in us again. Glory to God.
Thank you. et saecula.
In times when humanity disappoints, perhaps when even our own thoughts and behaviors disappoint, it is an important act to call out, name, and claim the consequences of our wrongs. And in times of distress, it is a prophetic act to call out, name, and claim our belief in the promise of joy. Join me in this litany of calling out, naming, and claiming. I believe that we have sometimes been silent in the face of injustice, and I believe that we are capable of raising our voices and insisting on goodness for all. I believe that we have been afraid of feeling deeply, making our joy small, and I believe that the deep joy of community can always be present even in hard times. I believe that sometimes we wonder if we can make a difference, and I believe that small acts of kindness and help do make a real difference. We believe even when we are discouraged. We believe that when we are discouraged, raising our voices for justice will offer us joy.
Will come again. Trust despite the deepening darkness, Christ will come again. Lift the world above its grieving through your watching and believing in the hope past hopes conceiving. Christ will come again. Probe the present with the promise, Christ will come again. Let your daily actions witness, Christ will come again. Let your loving and your giving and your justice and forgiving be a sign to all the living, Christ will come again. Match the present to the promise, Christ will come again. Make this hope your guiding promise, Christ will come again. Pattern all your calculating and the world you are creating to the advent you are waiting. Christ will come again.
I invite you to get into a comfortable position of rest. I invite you to get as quiet and still as you can. I invite you to a deep breath and a deep listening posture. perhaps eyes closed or fixed on a candle, as we prepare for a time of prayer. Worthy and holy God, you are pure joy. You bring hope and love and joy and peace into our world in this season when joy may be hard to come by. Help us fight even more fully to let it be born in us. Where there is despair at stats and numbers and restrictions, give us the joy of each breath and the joy of virtual means to connect and the joy of carols sung that still connect us to the holy. Remind us again, God, that joy doesn't come in perfect circumstances, nor because there is something particular in which to rejoice. Remind us that joy is a condition of life lived in relationship with you and in response to your love for us. So give us joy in you this season, so that we might join with the voices that rejoice in your coming. Give us joy like Mary, who though she knew the road ahead would be hard, counted it a blessing to be your servant. Give us the joy in knowing that you call us from where we are into meaningful ministry with you, and that that is joy enough for a lifetime. May it be so in us who pray in the name of Jesus, as he taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, which is the basis of our hymn tune, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee, has been a powerful witness to the human spirit to overcome adversity in many instances around the globe. First performed in 1824, it is a song about peace and represents the triumph of coming together against conflict and a hope for freedom and peace around the globe.
In this season of waiting, know this. We wait for justice, but we do not wait to work for change. We wait for restored health, but we do not wait to work to heal. We wait for wholeness, but we do not wait to work at binding brokenness. We wait for peace, but we do not wait to work to eliminate hatred. And so, my friends, like bells ringing out the news that God is ever present with us, fill the night left by sadness with messages of joy. Go into your lives humming the tunes that keep that joy alive in you and that spur you on in your work of justice and reconciliation. Raise your voices and repeat after me. Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Amen.